Have you online? No.
Yeah, we will folks who are just joining our live stream, we will be starting in just under a minute. So please stay tuned. We are making sure that the streams are working fine on YouTube. So we should be getting away soon.
There's a lot of people who have joined us on YouTube. If you check them out, there are quite a few of them.
Yeah, that's excellent. So we are just going to give about 30 seconds more for people to join in, and we will start the book publication program soon. So welcome to this broadcast. Just hang on for about half a minute.
Book publication program soon. So welcome to this broadcast. Just hang on for about half a minute.
Yeah, I'll request all the panelists to keep their mute on, because we are getting some echoes.
Yeah, I'll request the
live stream should be mute. The audio should be mute. Okay, I think this is better. So once again, good morning and very warm welcome to all of you on this Sunday morning for a very special program we have. We welcome all the viewers on YouTube as well as Facebook Live. We are here today to inaugurate the book written by my good friend, Dr. Uday Kulkarni. Dr. Uday Kulkarni, as many of you know, has written a series of books over the past decade on Maratha history. And he has done a phenomenal job of bringing this era of Maratha history, Indian history, in a sense, in front of the people. Because for a long time, many people were not very familiar, especially people outside Maharashtra, were not familiar with this very important aspect of Indian history. If you go back to the way the British wrote the history, we typically see the Mughal Empire in the 17th century, and then the British taking over in the 19th century. But the whole important 18th century of Indian history, where Marathas were the preeminent power and Pune was a de facto capital, is not widely covered. So Dr. Kulkarni, through his series of books, has done a great job of highlighting this part of history. And today we are going to launch his latest book on this particular era. So I'll give you a quick background about the program, and then we will move on very quickly to rest of the items here. So I'll have a brief introduction right now. This will be followed by an overview of the program, and we are going to do a brief introduction of our special guests. We have two very special guests. We are extremely honored to have Yashodhara Raje ji here with us, as well as Professor Makarand Paranthe. And we are very keen to hear their views about this era of history and the book as well. We'll be starting with the opening address by Dr. Uday Kulkarni about the book and about a summary of some of the key points that he has covered in the book. After that, we will do a book publication online. After that, I'll be doing a brief 10 to 15 minute interview with Dr. Uday Kulkarni. Many of you on Twitter and elsewhere have been sending me questions about the book, about this era of history, and the kind of things they would like to hear from Dr. Uday Kulkarni. So I'm going to pick up some of those questions and ask Dr. Kulkarni on behalf of all of you. This will be followed by the address by Professor Makarand Paranthe. That should be very interesting. And finally, we will have the keynote address by Shri Yashodhara Raje ji about the book and about the era. And we are also very interested in listening to some of her insights on this. And we'll close the program after that. So that we hope to close this by around 12:30. And hopefully we will be on time. So with this, let me invite Dr. Kulkarni to start his session to give us a brief overview about this new book, the era, the epoch, extraordinary epoch of Nanasaheb Peshwa, this amazing era of about 25 years in the middle of 18th century India. Dr. Kulkarni?
Thank you, Amit, and I hope I'm audible to everybody. Is
yes.
It okay? Okay. Actually, technology is a friend, but it can also be an adversary. And you know you are over 60 when you find it difficult to master it. So we had a bit of a problem. That's why we were a minute late. But this is a very unusual time because, you know, to speak without seeing your audience, without being able to see, gauge their reactions is a little difficult. But this pandemic has taught us a lot of things. We are going through an adverse period, and as the government says, that it's an adversity which has to be converted into the opportunity. And we are using that opportunity to have very eminent guests like Yashodhara Rajeji and Professor Paranjpe, who would otherwise not be available to us in a live book launch in Pune. But thanks to the online book launch, we can have eminent people like them today to speak to all of us. Now, just like we are kind of converting the adversity we have today into an opportunity, the Marathas did the same thing in the 17th and the 18th centuries. In the 17th century, a huge army came down from the north, and there were also armies in the south that was attacking the central portion, which was the buffer zone between the Maratha, between the Mughals and the Bahmani kingdoms. And that period of adversity was converted into an opportunity to develop a kingdom of its own. And that is what is the credit which we have to, which we owe, the debt which we owe to Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. The task he has done was something which was really humongous. And the founding of the empire was not a small task, was not an easy task. Inevitably, in history, as we see these days, there's a trend towards jumping from Mughal history directly into the British era. Obviously, this is not quite the case, because there was a period of about 150 years when the Marathas were a very prominent and very powerful entity in the Indian landscape. And this is the period that I would like to talk about, which has been often ignored by our historians, academicians, even our history books and so on. So this is the period, that 18th century, which we will be basically talking about, and which I have been trying to talk about for the last 10 years. It is very significant that the Marathas, because the British took over the empire from the Marathas when the Battle of Delhi was fought in 1803 between the forces of Daulatrao Sindhia and Lord Lake, who attacked Delhi. In fact, the five battles fought in that time. It is very significant that the British actually took over power from the Marathas. And therefore, it is even more important that we talk about this period. And what those people did in that era has actually come down to us to where we are today. Just a small example of the western boundary of India between India and Pakistan, you find several hundred kilometers, you find a river Satluj is flowing there. Now this marked the, this boundary stands today because of what these people did in the 18th century. And otherwise probably it would have moved even closer to Delhi. The significant part about the Marathas was that this was the last indigenous empire which arose from India. And at the same time, it was also the first indigenous empire that came after several centuries of rule by invading people, whether they were Afghans, whether they were the Turks, whether they were Central Asians. They all came down and they established their dynasties here. And the first time that an indigenous power stood up against them, gained their power, and for 150 years in between the Mughals and the British rule, you find this very glorious chapter which we in India can be proud of today. And that was created by the Marathas. So when the Marathas were attacked, the fight back which you saw in the last 27 years of the 17th century, it was that momentum which carried the Marathas forward into the 18th century towards a pan-Indian empire. And the collapse of the Mughals, which took place as a consequence of that, in fact, in the last years of Aurangzeb, you find the Mughal empire already is collapsing. The emperor died knowing that after me, the deluge practically. And you find that this collapse of the Mughals is what created a vacuum. It was a vacuum in the power center, and that vacuum was occupied by the emerging power of the day, which was the Marathas. Now, just to make a few points about what the Mughals are, because that is very debatable. It's a very debatable issue and a very hot topic today, whether they were Indians or not. Now, I would just like to point out a couple of things which can be taken into consideration while looking at the Mughals. Yes, they broke off all their connections with their homeland in Central Asia and they came to India and they stayed here. But at the same time, if you see the hierarchy of the Mughal nobility, the top mansabs were usually reserved for those with a Persian, Irani, Turani pedigree. And this is amply brought out by several historians such as Athar Ali from Aligarh Muslim University, who has given lists of people who are the number of people who the mansabdars, higher mansabdars, and so on. And the Persian was the court language right up to 1835. So these two factors should give us an example of what was the period before the Marathas came over, what it stood for. And Chhatrapati Shahu, he was imprisoned for a very long time in the Aurangzeb's court. So when he came, he had promised the emperor that he will protect the Mughal Empire, and that's what the Marathas did in the 18th century. In the time of Bajirao, you find for the first time the Marathas having attacked Delhi in 1737. Looking at the example of the Marathas coming and attacking Delhi, it is said that Nadir Shah sitting in Persia saw that this is a weakness of the king of Delhi, and 2 years later he came here and totally ransacked the city, looted the entire city, massacred hundreds and thousands of people. So 1739 is the watershed, I would say, after which the Mughals completely began to, diminish in their power, and the Marathas took over to such an extent that within 10 years, the Marathas were actually the protectors of the Mughals. So here, one finds that the adversarial relationship between the Mughals and Marathas changed. And at the start of this era, in 1740, was the time when Nanasaheb Peshwa came to the helm of affairs. And a famous historian has once commented that this revolutionary period comes only once in several centuries. It is at this period that Nanasaheb Peshwa was at the helm of affairs at the start of his epoch. And therefore, this is an important part of Indian history that we are trying to discuss over here. The Marathas went and protected the Mughals around 1752 when they signed an agreement which was basically signed on behalf of the Peshwa by Jayappa Sindhya and Mallarji Holkar, who were in Delhi at that time, who had fought on behalf of the emperor and defeated the Rohilas, who were attacking the Wazir at that point in time. And this was actually a kind of arrangement by which the Mughals reigned, but the Marathas ruled. Because the Mughal emperor thereafter was a puppet in the hands of the Wazir, and the Wazir was propped up by the Marathas. And that continued for the rest of the century until 1803. So that is what I would like to say. This is the same system was later on fine-tuned by the British when they introduced the subsidiary system, and all the native rulers were kind of allowed to rule in their provinces, but were kind of had the British oversight, which used to make sure that they follow the diktats of the British. So the same thing was done by the Marathas in respect to the Mughals. Now, the British just love calling the Marathas a confederacy, as if it was not a unified empire and it was split up into different parts, and there was no real king, there was nothing of that sort. But if you just look towards the end of the 18th century, I won't even look in the middle of it, where there is very conclusive evidence that it was a central power sitting either at Satara or Pune, and the chiefs were governing different provinces, and there was tremendous interconnections between the two. The many battles that the Marathas fought had all these chiefs fighting together, shoulder to shoulder. It was in the very end of the 18th century also, if you see, the during the time of the great Mahaji Shinde, when Mahaji Sindhya was that time the most powerful chief in the Maratha Empire also, the thousands of letters that passed between him and Pune testify to the close collaboration which was carried out by these two powers. It was only the distance that kept them apart. In the last 2 years of his life, he came to Pune because he wished to tutor the young Sawai Madhavrao, who was the Peshwa at that time. He finally died in Pune. So this entire myth about Marathas being a confederacy, it's high time that it is laid to rest, because we are just parroting the lines which were given to us by the British historians. So that is another point I would like to make. Finally, it was in Nanasaheb's time that the Marathas became India's most powerful state. At the same time, being protectors of the Mughals, you find Sadashivrao Bhau, when he went to the north, repeatedly writing in his letters that we want to preserve the Patshahi of the Chugtai dynasty, which is the Mughals. There is no place in this land for a foreigner such as Abdali. So the first enunciation of a nation state was also at that time, just 100 years after the Treaty of Westphalia, where Europe converted from the Roman Empire into separate states, nation states. And 100 years of that, we find these kind of letters coming up, which kind of recognize that India was a political union with some kind of defined, well-defined boundaries. So that was again, and the Marathas did not just say it. They were true to their words, because as we see towards the end of Nana Saheb's reign, they went 1,500 kilometers from their capital in Pune to fight a battle at Panipat. And at Panipat, they were basically there to fight against the invader who was coming from there, from the northwest, and to protect Delhi and the Mughal rule at that time. So they laid down 100,000 lives at that time in what was the fiercest battle of the 18th century. So let's look at the Maratha role throughout the 18th century. You find that, one, they were an indigenous empire. They were a nationalistic people. They conquered the land. At the same time, you don't find them indulging any kind of cruelty. You don't find any Maratha chief at the end of a battle having a pyramid of heads before his tent, as you find many of the, after Panipat, every chief had a, Afghan chief had a tent of heads which were cut off of the enemy at that time before their head. They did not massacre non-combatants. They were generous to the fallen enemy. Whether it was the Portuguese at Vasai, whether it was the Nizam on several occasions, whether it was the Mughals who were defeated by them several times, they were generous to a fallen foe and did not indulge in such kind of indiscriminate cruelty. So there lies the difference in a Bharati war, as they used to call it, and the kind of war which was perpetrated by the invaders on this India. So this book essentially is of a very momentous epoch. It tells us the story of the mid-18th century, and it uses contemporary sources which are in Marathi, which are in English, Portuguese, which are French and Persian. For this, I have had to refer to nearly 1,000 references which are given at the end of the book, over 38 chapters. At the start of this epoch, as I said, it was Nana Saheb who stood at the helm of affairs. And in his 20 years, the empire expanded to rival the empire that was there in the last years of Aurangzeb, which is the furthest extent of the Maratha, of the Mughals. For about 20 years, the Mughals reached the lowermost reaches of the Indian peninsula. The Marathas during Nana Saheb's time stretched from Attak to Katak, as it is famously said, and from the hills of Kamaon to the river Kaveri and Kolaru in the south. So that was the expanse in these 21 years that the Marathas went through. And that expansion was possible not very easily. It was because of the sacrifices which several of their chiefs had to give their lives for their empire at that point in time. So Nana Saheb held together the empire at this very crucial time. And I have used Charles Dickens' lines, opening lines of his famous novel here, and I've kind of changed them to read that it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, it was a time of betrayal, it was the age of cruelty and the era of chicanery, it was a season of change, it was an epoch of conquest, it was a spring of freedom, it was a dusk of bondage and to the high noon of nationalism. So that was a period which Nana Saheb Peshwa held together in those 21 years. So the book has roughly about 500 pages of text. There are about 18 art pages, which are about 40 plus pictures, and about 27 maps and illustrations, which help to the reader to navigate his way through the story of that those years. There's an index. There are genealogies which give you the family tree of various important families which ruled at that time. There are references. There's a glossary. There's a bibliography, and all these things are there for the for helping the readers to go through it. So this complex period that Nana Saheb went through, actually it helps you to navigate in every chapter. The story I have tried to tell in a chronological manner, because if I've seen previous historians have tried to group it, like the story of Bengal over the next 10 years, the story of Rajputana over the next 10 years. But by reading the history in that manner, you don't know that in 1742, what are the challenges that the ruler, that the Peshwa faced sitting in Pune, that there was a campaign going on in the Karnataka, another campaign was going on in Bengal, there was a disturbance going on in Bundelkhand, there were matters going on in Delhi, all of which required his attention at the same time. So telling the story chronologically, quite often you might find that the previous chapter is discussing the Carnatic Wars and the Anglo-French rivalry. The next chapter you go to Bengal, because that is where the timeline goes, and you cannot defy the timeline when you want to lay down the story. So that's what I've tried to do. Again, the book has, like my previous books, in Panipat, I had a sutradhar who kind of held the story together. And in Bajirao, there was the river Narmada tells you the story, and Rewa Uvach. So this time we have a Vakyanavis, very roughly translated to English as a remembrancer, who remembers the events and reports on them. And although he begins to tell the story, in between, after every few chapters, I've tried to introduce various topics, such as, for example, there's a famous letter of Nana Saheb, which he says that the rivers of gold from the north and the south have to flow to Pune. Unfortunately, the land in between is very barren and all the money doesn't reach here. So it's a very poetic letter written in very high quality Marathi. I mean, Nana Saheb was one of the greatest letter writers we had in the 18th century. And with his letters alone, he could probably win a war without really going to the battlefield. That's the diplomatic skill which this Peshwa had. And so then there's again a story about the Kashi Yatra. There's a Vakyanavis tells you about the Maratha cavalry. He tells you about various policies, judgments and orders passed during the time of Nana Saheb Peshwa from his Rojnishi or his diary. And so on. So you'll find many parts when every few chapters, you'll find a Vakyanavis interjecting the story and telling you about various things that happened during that time. This gives you an insight into administration. Hopefully, it will also develop an interest for people to dig deeper into these fields, which are ripe fields for further research and exploration. So let me tell you something about the book. The book begins in the Karnataka. And as you can see, these are the people who were instrumental in kind of developing that era, and they were spread out all over the place. They came from different families who were fighting for the Maratha state. And these people, the Chhatrapati Shahu and Nana Saheb Peshwa at the helm, are who created this empire, which really extended from the Maratha ditch of Calcutta to Gujarat, and from the from Punjab right up to the river Kaveri. And the influence of the Maratha Empire has been denied for so long that it's time that Indian historians begin to take note of it and try to understand what we are actually in for. So the book then proceeds on to the story of Karnataka. And we have genealogies which tell you the various families which were there at that time. Again, as I said, the book is not a biography. It's a story of a period. It follows a chronological path, not a regional one. And therefore, the timeline keeps shifting from chapters to chapters. It was a revolutionary period, as I said, in the history of the world. One historian has said, T.A. Shejwalkar, who is actually a critic of Nana Saheb, mentions in the preface to his book on written by Sardesai as long back as 1926, that in the history of the world, a revolutionary period comes after several centuries. In India, such a time came in the mid-18th century, and Nana Saheb Peshwa was the helm of affairs at the start of this epoch. It was this sentence which actually gave me the clue to what the name of the book should be, and that's why I've called it The Extraordinary Epoch of Nana Saheb Peshwa. And this is a story which I'm trying to tell, in which Nana Saheb Peshwa was the biggest player of them all. You'll find letters written by Nana Saheb to Robert Clive on the when he's about to go and capture Calcutta, and when he's about to go and fight the Battle of Plassey. So there was no part of India. There are letters written from Nana Saheb to Duplay and Duplay to Nana Saheb. Among the French sources that I found, which are probably being published for the first time, is a 1,000-volume book on the letters of Duplay, which were very, elegantly translated as long back as 1933 as a dissertation for the University of Massachusetts. So these materials have all come out for the first time, and you can really get a ringside view of French politics as it existed at that time. So as I said, the story begins in Karnataka, centers around the cities of Trichinopoly and Tanjavur, where the disturbances began, and the Maratha army had to march down there under Raghuji Bhosle to put things right in 1740. Once Trichinopoly was captured by Raghuji, it was handed over to Murarao Ghorpade for looking after, and Raghuji returned to Nagpur with Chanda Sahib, who was the Nawab there, as a prisoner. And following that, you find Raghuji heading towards Bengal. And the next 10 years of his life, Raghuji was involved in Bengal. Why did he go to Bengal? Because just around that time, in 1740, the dynasty of Murshid Kuli Khan that was ruling in Bengal was kind of removed, and one of their ministers, Ali Wardi Khan, usurped them. So, in fact, one of the British authors called Holwell, he doesn't address Ali Wardi Khan by his name, he calls him the usurper. And the Marathas actually went to Bengal to, on the invitation of one of the people from who are opposing Ali Wardi Khan, to come and rescue the area there. So these are the stories, and this is how you keep going on the western coast of India, which was where the British were at Bombay, and the Angre power in the Konkan coast there was a dispute between the Maratha central power of Shah Chhatrapati Shahu and Nana Saheb Peshwa and the Angre family, which was divided into two parts between Manaji and Tulaji Angre and Vijay Durg. That story has been described over quite a few in vivid detail over four or five chapters. Then you come to the succession of the Maratha succession, I would say, which was a very difficult time for Nana Saheb personally. For some time, in fact, before Shahu Maharaj expired, Nana Saheb was even removed from the Peshwa's post because there were a lot of factions in the Darbar at that time and a lot of stories which were being circulated about him. And when he emerged from that, after that, he earned his king's trust. He was made the kind of mukhtiyar of the kingdom after the death of the king. And he had to, the domestic enemies which came up at that time, he had to kind of suppress them before he could continue looking at the other issues that were facing him. And most important of these was the situation in Delhi, because Ahmad Shah Abdali had already begun attacking the Punjab, and there were already three invasions which had taken place by 1752. There was the rise of the English and the French in the Karnataka. And these were the problems which happened between those very turbulent 4 years when things were going on around Satara and Pune. And it was in 1752, after all these things were put behind him, that Jayappa and Mallarji actually signed a treaty called the Ahadnama with the Wazir, who was Safdarjung at that time, promising to protect the Mughal Empire against all his internal and external enemies, which included Ahmad Shah Abdali. And that is how gradually the Marathas were pulled into the politics and into the defense of the frontier lands of Punjab. The year 1753 to 55 was a long campaign which took place, which was led by Raghunath Rao, Mallarji Holkar, and they kind of captured a lot of land. They entered Doab also at that time. And from there, they took back Delhi from the Mughal king, put their own wazir there. The king was deposed, a new emperor was appointed, and so on. Jayappa ji went to Rajasthan that time, where he was unfortunately assassinated while negotiating with the wakils of the king of Jodhpur. And in 1757, Abdali came for the second time to Delhi, and he even came down to Mathura and Vrindavan. He looted the whole capital. In fact, it is famously said that the amount of loot that he earned at that time was so much that he had to carry away every animal in Delhi to load it and take it back to his homeland. And not a washerman's donkey was left behind. Everything was taken. All the animals were taken away. This was followed by the famous Maratha campaign, which went from Jaipur, went to Delhi, took back Delhi from Najibullah, who was the Rohila chief of Najibabad. From there, they entered the Punjab. Lahore was then under Taimur Shah Abdali, who was Abdali's son, and his general Jahan Khan. They chased them out of Lahore. They defeated them, sent them to Attock. The further armies were sent to Attock, which was captured. Peshawar was taken. Multan was taken. So these four places, several of the Maratha generals were there. Mallarji Holkar was there. Tukoji Sindhya was there. Sabaji Sindhya was there. Renko Appaji was there. Manaji Paigude was there. Raghunath Rao was there. So all these Maratha chiefs who went that time, they captured this entire territory. And that is the time, for nearly 18 months, you find that Attock, Peshawar, Multan and Lahore were under Maratha rule. And that was probably the zenith of Maratha power towards the fag end of Nana Saheb's reign. From here, we find that the enemies, this is a picture of Raghunath Rao, which I recently discovered at a Salarjung museum. From here you find there's a kind of the success that the Marathas achieved right from the north to the south. You found enemies arising from every side, and the Afghan descendants, in fact, there's a letter which has been written some time back, which is the state in India which does not have Pathans. So every army right from the southern peninsula to the north had Pathans in their army, and that the northern belt, which was beyond the Ganga, north of the Ganga, was completely, the Rohilas were at Bareilly, they were at Farukhabad, they were at Najibabad. So their entire track was of the Rohilas, who were basically first or second generation immigrants from Afghanistan. So when they found that their area is threatened by the Maratha advent to the north, they asked for help from Ahmad Shah Abdali to come down and rescue them. And that was the genesis of actually the adversity between the Marathas and the Afghans. Well, this story goes on and leads up to Panipat in the end. On the other hand, you have the Anglo-French rivalry which took place in Karnataka. And the battle which centered around Trichinopoly, which remained the pivot of South Indian politics for almost 15 years. So Trichinopoly was a very important fort at that time. And you find the English, the French, Maratha armies under Murarao Ghorpade, the army from Mysore under its Pradhan, who was Nanjaraj, and Duplay, Clive, their people, Stringer Lawrence, who's still considered the father of the Indian army. All these people you find gathering around Trichinopoly trying to capture their fort until finally, you'll be surprised to hear this, that not very commonly known, but the government of Madras, which was the East India Company's government, they wrote letters to the Secretary of State in London that please influence the British, please influence the French government to remove Duplay from this post. And these letters are there in British Library. I've seen them. And this, within a year after that, you find that Duplay is removed from his post and a man called Godet, who comes in his place, who signs a treaty with the English. And practically the removal of Duplay from the scene was the beginning of the end of the French power in India, because the people who came after him were not able to face up to the English in any. And the English at that time had people like Robert Clive, who were coming in, a very ambitious man, a lot of chutzpah. And he was actually the founder of British rule in India, because in 1755, actually, when there was a dispute between Tulaji Angre and Nana Sahib, and he signed an alliance with the Bombay government. And the British Navy at that time came down to India. They had come here for a different purpose. They had decided that they will send their navy here to fight with the French, who had taken over the government of the Nizamul Mulk at Hyderabad. But by the time they reached here, the purpose of the expedition had changed, and a treaty was signed between the Marathas and the British to take Vijayadurg back from Tulaji Angre. Because Tulaji Angre was, for various reasons which I've discussed in the book, was an autonomous power by himself. He was ill-disposed to the English, but at the same time, he was not following the instructions given by the Peshwa. So it became essential to replace him. And for that, a battle had to be fought by sea by the English and by land by the Marathas. And that is what eventually led to the Battle of Vijayadurg, which was taken by the Marathas, and Tulaji Angre was captured. Vijayadurg was taken back from the English, and his assistant, who was Dhulap, Sardar Dhulap, was appointed in Vijayadurg thereafter. So this happened during this time. Within a month of this happening, you find that Sirajuddaullah in Bengal takes Vijayadurg, takes Calcutta back from the English. And at that point, you can say the English were at the lowest point in India, because they had lost their possessions in Bengal. In Madras, they had not yet completely overcome the French. And that was a time when Robert Clive, with a big armada of ships, went up the Hooghly and began his venture to take back Calcutta. So all these things were happening at the same time. When Abdali was here in Mathura and Delhi, the Battle of Plassey was happening in Calcutta. So all these things, if you look at them chronologically, you realize that it's the same time, different events happening in different parts of the country. So I have described the Battle of Plassey, even before the Battle of Plassey, because there was an alliance with the English. Nana Sahib always had his eyes on Bengal. When Raghuji Bhosle died in 1756 and Aliwardi Khan died immediately after that, the English got an opportunity to enter Bengal without Maratha oversight. And that was the time Battle of Plassey was fought. But you find a letter by Nana Sahib written to Roger Drake, who was the governor of Calcutta, saying that if you like, I will send an army of 70,000 people here to Bengal to assist you to overthrow the Nawab. The idea being that eventually Bengal will be pocketed by the Marathas. So these politics and the strategies during this era followed by the Peshwa were something which is in detail, which are complex and which are really to be understood if you read them from that point and see what exactly was happening. The Battle of Panipat took place. The Nizam before that was extinguished. I mean, his power was practically extinguished at Sindhkhed and Udgir. And at the end of Battle of Panipat, you find that Nana Sahib was so seriously ill at that stage. He had lost about 30 kg in weight at the very early age of 40 years. I would say that it was an unfinished innings that he died at that point in time. So the book tells you about all these things and more. The book is about 200,000 words. And I could only complete it in such a short time because of this enforced lockdown that all of us had to endure. And now with these three books on Panipat, Bajirao, and the extraordinary epoch of Nana Saheb, I finished the story till 1761. And the Marathi edition of Bajirao is coming up next. And the next stage will begin with the Madhavrao of Peshwa's time, which will end in 1772. So I hope to finish that as the next book. And then there is a story of Uttar Peshwa, as it is called, because the Peshwa effectively ended with the death of Madhavrao Peshwa. And the next Peshwa who came was barely 40 days old when he was appointed to that post. And that is a period which is primarily the time of Mahaji Shinde and Nana Fadnis. So after I finish with the book on Madhavrao, I aim to take up that project, which is a very, very complex period, even more complex, I would say, than Nana Saheb Peshwa. And to bring those strings apart and lay them before the readers is going to be a challenging task. But with the blessings of my readers, I hope I can go on and complete this task. Finally, I would say that we in Maharashtra today are really honored that Yashodhara Raje Shindia is with us. When I met her earlier this year, the first thing she told us was that please speak to me in Marathi. And I was a bit taken aback because I thought that, you know, by this time, over the last 2.5 centuries, they would have forgotten their Marathi roots. But that is not the case. She's very proud of her history. She's very proud of her heritage. And she would like to pass it on to future generations. And I found that she's very passionate about it. And that's why I find that for this particular book, I could not have found a more appropriate person to come as a chairperson. Because this period from 1740 to 1761, the sacrifices of the Shindia family, and I mean it in the real sense of the word, in 1743, Ranoji's son, Jyotiba Shindia, was killed in a battle with the king of Orcha. 1745, Ranoji died of natural causes. 1754, Jayappa Shindia was assassinated while fighting with the king of Jodhpur in the course of negotiations. It was an assassination, actually. In 1760, you find Dattaji Shindia defending Delhi against the Ahmad Shah Abdali and Najib Khan. And he was waiting for Mallara Holkar to join him, who was delayed, held back, whatever you want to say, and he died just north of Delhi at Buradi Ghat. 1 year later at Panipat, you find Tukoji Shindia and Janakoji Shindia both getting killed in the Battle of Panipat. So five people of this family gave their lives for the Maratha Empire in this 20-year period of which this book deals with. So as I said, I could not have found a more appropriate person to come here as a chairperson today. And I'm really grateful that she has taken so much time off from the one holiday that she has in the day. I know she's very busy for the rest of the week. So I'll just say this, that Professor Bakrant Paranswami, of course, he's a polymath in the real sense of the word. As I see it, he's a poet, a philosopher, doctorate in English literature. For long, he has been a professor in Jawaharlal Nehru University, which is saying a lot. And presently, as the director of the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies in Shimla, he's doing a lot of job because we are seeing online sessions conducted almost every week. So I would say that, again, we are very honored that because of the online sessions which we are having, we are able to have him here. Now, Amit Paranswami has not introduced himself, so let me say a few words about him. That first thing, thank you very much for consenting to moderate this event. Amit, of course, is a good friend of mine and a man of many parts. He is an ex-IIT Bombay man. He is a startup entrepreneur. He returned to India after spending several years in the US. And he has always been at my back, prodding and encouraging me to write. And when is the next book finishing is his first question whenever we meet. And he is very knowledgeable on everything, not just history, about technology and about current affairs. He's a cricket fan and probably attends every match that is there in India. He probably knows cricket statistics better than anybody else. And in technology, again, his interest is deep and abiding. And if I'm allowed to guess, I would say that his role model would be Elon Musk. Please correct me if I'm wrong. And to sum up, then, I do hope you all like this book. It is in a non-fiction format. It is not a rapid reader. It has been savored, like connoisseurs will say, like good wine. And if I look back at the book now, I really can't believe that I finished this work in this short time. And I must have been truly possessed to be able to complete it. Thank you all for a very patient hearing. I hope I have not overshot my mark. And I'll now request Amit to take the program forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Uday. Thank you very much, Dr. Kulkarni. I think this is the book itself is an epoch. I think you have written some great books. Viewers here would be familiar with some of the earlier books of Dr. Kulkarni: Solstice at Panipat, Bajirao, also the James Quayle's book. And I think, and I've been a fan of all these books over the last decade, but I think this is probably your best book. And I'm not saying because this is a recent book, but just the depth that you have put into it and the amount of work, the amount of research. As I said, it's 200,000 plus words, 500 pages, and it's such a complex period of Indian history. I remember our discussion 2 weeks back when I started reading the preprint copy. What do you think of it? And I think my first description at that time, and I still think it's very valid, it's complex, but it's captivating. And I think it has to be that way because the history is so complex that if you had tried to simplify it, it wouldn't have done justice to it. So I think it needed that level of in-depth scholarship that you have shown. And I think that's why readers are going to enjoy this book even more than some of the earlier books. I'll just like to highlight one point here that this book is already available on sale on Amazon.in. So I posted the link multiple times on Twitter. It will be posted here again on the channel. But if you go to Amazon.in and go to Dr. Uday Kulkarni's author page, you will find links to this book as well as the earlier books. And I strongly recommend you read the earlier books as well, and definitely buy this particular one. So now we are going to do a formal online book launch. So if I ask Yashodhara Rajeji and Makaranji to have their copy, and this is a unique, different world right now, so we have to sort of just show the book on the screen, and then we will declare take off the wrappers, and then we will declare the book publication done. So while everyone is opening their book, after this I'm going to do a brief interview with Uday. So I think we can now declare that the book published. We'll just keep this for a photo, for a screen capture.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Dr. Kulkarni.
Thank you very much. I think we'll move on to the next part of the program. So I would formally introduce Dr. Uday Kulkarni because he really needs no introduction amongst all his fans who have joined in today. But I'll just mention a couple of things about him instead of giving a long bio for a few new people out here. Dr. Uday Kulkarni is an AFMC graduate and a Navy surgeon. Many people may not realize that. And he served in the Indian Navy for many years. After the Indian Navy, he did a postgraduate course in journalism purely as a hobby, because I'm pretty sure he didn't intend to be a journalist. He even taught that. So talk about his both his capability as well as his discipline when he takes up anything new. And then, of course, he was continuing his practice. He is a GI and a general surgeon. He's been continuing his medical practice. And then he started writing books on history. And that's something that we are going to talk about in our brief interview shortly. But I'll say one thing, and I'm sure Dr. Kulkarni will think that I'm exaggerating a little bit, but we have had this amazing tradition of historians, historians who are focused on Maratha history, going back all the way to Rajwade, Sardesai, Yadunath Sarkar. And Dr. Kulkarni is really carrying forward that legacy. And I know, these are very large shoes to fill, but he's, over the last 10 years, what Dr. Kulkarni has done is really at that level of contribution. His 4 books and the 3 new ones that will be coming up shortly in the next few years is that level of contribution. What has happened is, we have had a lot of good Maratha history written in Marathi, but it was very important to take it to English because that's one way to get it read by people all over India and outside India. And I think that's been his amazing, absolutely amazing contribution. So I think, Dr. Kulkarni, let's start with our brief interview based on some of the questions that we have been receiving from so many of your readers. And first question that comes to mind for many people is, how did you turn into a historian? What triggered the book on Panipat about a decade back? Because that's where it all started.
Actually, I really we'll have to go back to 1966, because that is when I was in school, and I was in a boarding school. When we used to finish our homework in our prep classes, we had free time, and I had a notebook. We used to take a 200-page notebook, and in Marathi in that time, I wrote the Mughal Maratha Charitra. I was in standard 6. And wow. 3 years later, when I was in standard 9, I felt that book is a bit kind of childish. So I rewrote it, and that copy I still have with me. And I even called it Don Darbar. So that is probably, it was inbuilt. I mean, I just had that interest right from the beginning. My grandfather was a historian. He had a good library, and I used to read his books right from childhood. So maybe that kind of helped. There were some beautiful books he presented me, which were on Shivaji Maharaj and so on. So that probably built up the interest in the beginning. And then I kept reading as I continued doing my medical practice. I kept reading alongside several books and so on. But when you read these books and you read the commentary that these authors have for any particular period which they have, whether it's Jaddunal Sarkar, whether it's Sardesai, whether it's Shejwalkar, you're always struck by something is missing and the interpretation is not right, or the kind of presentation is something you don't agree with. So that feeling kept building up within me whenever I used to read these authors. And around 2010, when the Battle of Panipat was going to be having its 250th anniversary, I remember the late Dinanath Bedekar and even Pandurangji Balkavde, they were all going out of their way to really commemorate that occasion. So I felt that I should write a small essay or a monograph on that battle. But when I found the material available, I said this cannot fit into a monograph, and ended up becoming a book. And that book I completed on 14th of January 2011, and was published 2 months later. Again, I didn't waste any time going to a publisher. I started my own publishing company, Mula Mutha Publishers. Mula Mutha, the two rivers which you find in Pune. So I found that is an apt name to give a publishing house. And since then, I've never gone to any publisher, because I think I have got a weakness that I cannot delegate my responsibilities to anybody else. And I like to make sure that the finished product is the way I want it. And unfortunately, when it goes to the publisher's hands, there is a very little role the author has to play, right from the type of paper used, the type of binding, the type of covers. And I'm very fussy about these small little things. So I think maybe it's something wrong with me, but anyway, that's what led me to bring out these books myself. And it's a learning process. I mean, you learn how to, and thankfully for me, that time online sellers like Amazon and Flipkart came into India at the same time. And that was a big boost, because you send 100 books to their warehouse and they just start getting dispatched without you doing anything further. So, and with social media coming in a big way at that particular time, it also helped to promote these books and these thoughts which you have about history. So that's how it kept building. I mean, it was not a planned journey. It just started off, and that's where it has brought me here to this day today.
Excellent. And I think social media has definitely played a part in getting the word out. And you have really filled this important missing gap that I alluded to at the beginning of the talk of the 18th century history. Now, your next book, After Solstice at Panipat, was about the great Bajirao. And one question that many readers have asked, and it's a natural question that comes to mind in many people's mind after they have read the Bajirao book and they're looking forward to this book, is what were the main differences between the father and the son? As you know, Nana Saheb was the son of Bajirao, but they were quite different in many respects, right?
Actually,
so if you can highlight some of that, because I think that's a question in minds of many people. How do you compare and contrast?
Actually, comparisons are always odious, and I hate to compare two rulers, because the times are different, circumstances are different in which they are operating. So naturally, their actions are different. But very broadly speaking, I would say that during Bajirao's time, Chhatrapati Shahu was still very strong and young and relatively in control. And therefore, the role which Bajirao Peshwa had, at least in the first 15 years of his time, last 5 years, he was practically his own master. He had to kind of be under the guidance of his monarch. Also, Bajirao was more of a general and less of a, like you say in Marathi or Hindi, less of a Rajyakarta or a ruler. In Nana Saheb's time, as those 21 years of his rule progressed, you find that Chhatrapati Shahu's illness, his domestic troubles, so on, which have been described in this book, progressively you find that Nana Saheb emerging as an alternative power center. And in the second half of Nana Saheb's reign, he practically is the is not just the prime minister, he's also the sovereign. He's functioning like the sovereign for reasons which are described in the book. The why the sovereignty moved from the king to the Peshwa after the death of Shahu has been discussed in this book in all its, I mean, made threadbare for people to follow with all the reference given. So these are the two different roles. Nana Saheb was not a general like Bajirao was. He was more of a ruler and a prime minister. And as a prime minister, doesn't go to battle. Nana Saheb did go to battle, but not on the forefront like Bajirao had to. Bajirao had to keep proving himself to his king. Nana Saheb was not under the same compulsions, at least in the second half of his reign. And he had a set of very able people, very able chiefs, who were able to carry out that responsibility. So because of that, he was delegate those responsibilities of the in the military field to all the chiefs who were there at that point in time. Okay. And many of the letters which are there in the book, you'll find that he urges his chiefs, please come down to the Deccan, I need you here. When Jayappa Shindya and Malarji were in the north, he says, please come here, you're going to help the Wazir over there, but here I'm in trouble. So those kind of letters give you a picture of what is the difference in these two rulers.
Right. So I think there are many questions, but I'm just going to take one, and then we definitely want to hear from Makranji and Yashodhara Rajeji. So the last question is, you mentioned about how Nana Saheb oversaw the largest extent of the Maratha Empire around the middle of 18th century. What were his administrative skills? What were his administration skills? What were some of the things that helped him? You mentioned about his letter writing and diplomacy. If you can elaborate a little bit on that.
Since Bajirao was mostly in the field, he had very little time for administration. His brother Chimaji Appa managed most of that part of the story. But Nana Saheb was a more settled administration. And therefore, he could really streamline the way the administration of the kingdom, a far-flung kingdom, should work. So there were representatives of the, or of Phadnis, so to say, in each, with each chief. There was a representative in every chief's capital or in his army who would report back to the Peshwa, who would check the accounts, that the revenue is being sent back to Pune and so on. So he kind of spread that entire network all over the country from where he was getting reports back. And there was a certain delegation of responsibility even in Pune, especially after Sadashivrao Bhau came into his own. He was appointed a Diwan and he took over the responsibility of admin. There are letters by English wakils who came to India that it is actually the rule of Nana and Bhau. But Nana Saheb mostly defers or refers most of the decisions to Sadashivrao Bhau. This is what the English envoys who came to Pune have written. So he had the luxury of delegating administration after some time to his subordinates. Okay. And he built a very elaborate system for administration during that time.
Yeah, I think you should definitely read the book to learn more about that. But just reading some of his letters gives you great insight into some of his administration capabilities and his thinking. I mean, here was a person who was a deep thinker, a deep strategist, and thinking many moves ahead. And with all these parallel events happening, the English-French on one side, Abdali on the other, Central India, you know, problems happening at home, to juggle through all of that and come up with all these decisions and execute them and monitor them was just absolutely fascinating. So thank you, Uday. We definitely want to hear from Makranji. I'm going to do a very, very brief introduction of Makranji, and then I'm also very keen to listen to his thoughts. All of his talks are always very, very fascinating. So Makran Paranspe is currently the director of India Institute of Advanced Studies in Shimla. He studied at the St. Stephen's College in Delhi and University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, where he got his master's and PhD in English. He's been a professor at JNU for many years. He's been an author of 30 plus books and has reviewed many books, has written a lot of academic papers. I'll just mention one of his latest books that I finished reading just a few months back about Swami Vivekananda. And it's an absolutely fascinating book, a book that really explains Swami Vivekananda, if you haven't really understood the many facets of his amazing personality and his work, I would recommend that book as well. And just my regular reminder about Dr. Uday Kulkarni's book as well, it's available on Amazon.in. Just search for his author's page. So, Makranji, we are all waiting to hear from you. Over to you. Are you on mute?
Thank you so much, Amit. It's wonderful. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, Amit. And it's wonderful to be in this program. And my respects to our chief guest, as well as my heartiest congratulations to Dr. Uday Kulkarni. This is an extraordinary book. I must say that I think it's going to be one of the books that define our understanding of this 18th century period. As Udayji rightly put it, this is, you know, a long durée century. You know, we used to think about the 19th century as the long century. But I think for India, the 18th century is an equally long century, very, very eventful. And when we try to understand, you know, we have been told that we are all prisoners of our past. We are all prisoners of history. But as Sri Aurobindo showed us, that we have to understand our past not just from the yardstick or point of view of the present, but actually of the future. Now, this is a very profound point which needs elaboration. Maybe we won't have time for it today. But the point I'm trying to make is that this is a book which actually enables us not to be prisoners of the past, not to be, you know, it enables us to be free from, to some extent at least, to free us from the prison house of history. Now, why do I say that? I say that because we know that recent Indian historiography has been dominated by two schools. One you might call, for lack of better terms, the left liberal school, and then subsequently, as an offshoot of this school, was the subaltern school of history. And what these two schools of history did is that they emphasized a certain aspect of our past and really pushed into the corner, pushed into the margins, other events and facts which were actually essential to understand, as I said, not only our present but our future. Let's try to therefore look at the achievement of Dr. Kulkarni from that perspective. And if you look at Indian history in the modern period, that is after colonialism, after we got colonized, then we see a progression of sorts from the Orientalist view of India as, you know, it was not an unflattering view. It was a somewhat idealized view of our past. And Indians of the Vedic times and beyond were seen as an extraordinarily highly developed civilization. And then came the imperialist school, when the British gradually attained paramountcy. A part of that is in this book, you know, Clive, how he beat Siraj-ud-Daula, who was the maternal grandson of Ali Wardi Khan, this great man who was the usurper, as Udayji said, and who, in a way, controlled the destinies of Bengal for a very long time. He died at the age of 90, if I remember right. But Ali Wardi Khan was important because Bengal was the richest province of India. So I'll come back to that. But the point I'm trying to make is that when the British attained paramountcy of India in the early 19th century, maybe, you know, a defining moment might have been the Third Anglo-Maratha War, 1818. So the long 18th century, I would say, began with the death of Aurangzeb, 1707, and continued till, in a sense, the defeat of the Marathas in 1818. Now, the point is that when the British attained paramountcy, the Orientalist way of looking at India yielded to the imperialist notion of India, which was really, I would say, it was a paratantra. It foregrounded the paratantra view of India as opposed to the swatantra view of India. Okay, so now you had the Orientalist school, then the imperialist school, and then somebody like Savarkar in 1909, sitting in the British Library, wrote the first Indian War of Independence, and in a way, you know, started a different way of looking at India's past. And the nationalist school of historiography was also birthed around the late 19th century and gave Indians a different way of understanding their past. And Savarkar's book provided a much-needed impetus to the nationalist school. The nationalist school yielded a lot of very important historians, Jadunath Sarkar, Sardesai, Rajwade, R.C. Mojumdar, and all of these people did yeoman service to our understanding of our past. But then, actually, paradoxically, in the post-independence period, it's not the nationalist historians who came into prominence, but there were really state-sponsored historians of the left orientation, Irfan Habib, Romila Thapar, Satish Chandra, a number of these historians, Harbans Mukhya, a lot of them were from JNU, I'm afraid, and they dominated Indian history writing. They and their students dominated Indian history writing, and they gave a certain kind of secularist spin to Indian history. Whereas you'll see in Udayaji's book, at every moment, people are deeply religious, and these were wars that were fought largely, I would say, between people belonging to opposing religious views. Which brings me to another school of Indian historiography, which is not fully bloomed yet, but which came up almost as a reaction to the Marxist historiography. And it was led by people who were amateurs. They were not PhDs in history. That the fact that they were amateurs didn't mean that they were not trained or that they were in any ways deficient in their scholarship. I mentioned two names which are extraordinary, Ram Swarup and Sitaram Goyal, and later to some extent Arun Shori. they took up the gauntlet. And then you had a trained historian, academic, Conrad Elst, who also contributed to this school, which we may call, the Hindutva school. And you don't like the name, you can call it something else. I have a different name. I'm going to come to that name in a moment. But then you had the subalterns who really talked about history from below and also a kind of micro history. So that you didn't talk any more about the large things, imperial or the national or even the Marxists who were talking about very large things because they saw history as class conflict. The bourgeoisie rising against, the older aristocratic and the ruling classes, which were feudal, right? And the bourgeoisie rising through commerce and capitalism, and then the proletariat waiting in the wings. So the Marxists had that view of class conflict as the driver of history. And of course, the Hindutva historians saw history as being driven by a civilizational conflict between indigenous people and invaders. And in this whole panoply of Indian historiography, you might think about an important figure, Jawaharlal Nehru, who wrote The Discovery of India. And you'll see that in The Discovery of India, again, this paratantra, you see, is central because he sees India in terms of all the invaders who came right back, going back to Alexander and so forth. The Mughals, the British, and then he sees somehow India as a palimpsest, layer upon layer, and there's no core to India at all. And he sees somehow himself and the Congress that he as an inheritor of this paratantra view of history. Now, why do I bring this up? Because I think it's this time of the 18th century was really very crucial. Before that, you have a very, very important figure whom we all love with our Maharashtrian and Maratha links, Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, born in 1630, if I remember right, and he passed away in 1680. Now, this date, 1630, is really, really important because of Swaraj. So I propose that there is a school of history which takes from all these schools that I've talked about, because it's not really ideologically driven entirely. Udayji also says you have to be dispassionate when you write history. History is not ideology, though it may be informed by your ideological concerns. But it is a Swarajist school of history. So the Swarajist school looks at Swatantra, not Paratantra, as a driving force in history. And the Swarajist impulse is to resist, you know, conquest, domination, slavery, and subordination by others, and not to do so yourself when you're powerful. As Udayji shows in the book, the Marathas were much more gentle, though they're called Bargis and all sorts of bad names, looters. They imposed Chauth and Sadeshmukhi in the regions that they, if not conquered, they subdued. But except for some stray incidents, we have the incident of the conquest of Bengal, where at one point, the Marathas did, I think, commit a number of atrocities. It's there in the book as well, while they were looting the countryside. But by and large, they were much more benign than those who raised pyramids of skulls. But so the Swarajist impulse in India, despite the almost 800-year interregnum of Islamic rule, and we must also admit that the Muslims became a part of India when they ruled India, and the Maratha armies also had leading commanders who were Muslims. Ibrahim Khan, who led the artillery in the Battle of Panipat, the Third Battle of Panipat, 1761. I'll come back to that in a moment. But the point I'm trying to make is that the impulse for Swaraj never died down. So between the Battle of Talikota, where the Vijayanagar Empire was liquidated, when all the sultanates of the south, the Bahmanis, the Bijapuris, the Golconda, everybody combined the Nizam Shahi, before the Nizams, you know, the Asif Jah, they combined and defeated, destroyed the Vijayanagar Empire. And even today, if you go to Hampi, you'll see a ruined city, right? Completely ruined, all the temples destroyed and so forth. Now that 1565, if I remember right. So in 1565, Vijayanagar Empire is destroyed. It lasts for about 300 years. And Shivaji is born in 1630. So that's less than 100 years, you know. It's a period of about, you might say 65 years. And then with Shivaji, again, the quest for Swaraj starts. Shivaji passes away in 1680. And Aurangzeb in 1707. And the now I'm coming to this long 18th century that I'm talking about. And how during less than 20, 30 years, the Mughal Empire is also brought down. You have a series of very ineffectual rulers, which are there. If you look at the charts at the beginning of the book, the Mughal emperors after Aurangzeb, who died in 1707, and he spent the last 20 years of his life trying to subdue the Deccan, and died at Aurangabad in the Bibi Ka Maqbara, which he wanted to be even greater than the Taj Mahal, but unfortunately ran out of money. He died there. He spent the last 20 years of his life destroying all the other principalities in the south. But soon after his death, you had a series of so-called emperors, Mughal emperors, Shah Alam I, Jahandar Shah, nobody's heard of them, ruling for a year or two, Farooq Sheyar, Rafi Ud Darjat. Who's heard of Rafi Ud Darjat? I never heard of him myself. Rafi Ud Dawla. These are really ineffectual rulers. And then you had this Muhammad Shah Rangila, who, by the way, was a great patron of music. And even today, many of the bandishes you hear go back to Muhammad Shah Rangila. But it was at this time, in the power vacuum, as Udayji told us, that the Maratha power rises. And this period is extremely important, because when we come to the Battle of Panipat, you know, which was also a very decisive battle, and Nana Saheb Peshwa was not there in the battlefront. And in fact, you know, he was getting married again. Nobody knows exactly why. He was not there, but the Marathas suffered enormously. And of course, Ahmad Shah Abdali also suffered. He didn't remain for long in India. And in between, Nadir Shah, 1739, I think. So the Mughal Empire was practically destroyed in 1739. But certain other things which are very important also happened in this long 18th century. First of all, the Marathas were able to defeat the Portuguese, which showed that the Europeans were not invincible. But unfortunately, they also brought down the Angres, who were their great support, semi-independent though they were, in controlling the coast. And those who controlled the seas would control India. And the Marathas lost out their sea power because of their own internal fights. That was another second very important thing. The third important thing for me was that a small group of Europeans was able to show that they could defeat very large and bloated Nawabi armies, okay? So you had two absolutely different kinds of warfare going on in India at that time. Think about 1757, the Battle of Plassey, where about 5,000 troops, you know, under this intrepid man, Clive, Robert Clive, who was a freebooter, an adventurer, a clerk, quite suicidal, in fact, manic depressive, but quite intrepid. In the siege of Arcot, he again showed the British didn't want to support him. He beat back the Nawab of Arcot. So he was really a great strategist. So 5,000 people defeated the Dowlah's army of more than a lakh. Of course, Mir Jafar was a traitor and so forth. But I think even more dramatic, you know, as a prelude to how the Europeans fought in India, were two battles, you know, the Battle of Madras, where Dupley conquered, you know, he invaded Madras and took over, and the Battle of Hyderabad, which is also in this book, where Debussy, he came and he camped in the Charminar, which was a crossroads, that's why it's called Charminar, and he mounted his cannons and artillery on top of the Charminar, and he beat back the Marathas, the Nawabs, Marathas who were in the employ of the Nizam, and everybody who came. So, and in Madras, you saw how near Adyar, you saw that the French, you know, what used to happen is the Indian cavalries would attack, and they were quite swift, and they would cut down the musketeers, people who fought with guns. But the French demonstrated that they could reload their weapons very fast. And they could cut down a cavalry of 20,000 with 200 men. So the battle in India in the 18th century, and you can see this in this book when you contrast the great battle in Panipat, the third battle of Panipat, where lakhs of people were fighting. I say lakhs because the camp followers of the Marathas and Abdali were about 5 lakhs. The soldiers themselves were about 100,000 on each side in different groups. Now, this was a battle fought on a plain. You know, if you go to Panipat today, it's a huge battleground, right? Whereas the Battle of Plassey was not fought on a plain. And there were ditches, and it was not an even plain. And the guns played a large role because it rained the previous night. And Clive had fever, he had malaria. It's not, all of this is not in the book. This I'm telling you from my other readings. And he was delirious. And his people said, look, you're going to die tomorrow. And he said, okay, we'll think about tomorrow. And what saved him is that his powder was dry. Whereas the French mercenaries fighting for Siraj ud-Daulah, they had exposed their powder and their guns were ineffective because it rained the previous night. Now, the point I'm trying to make is that these two battles in the 18th century defined the fate of India. You saw that battles were not fought on large plains with large armies anymore, but were fought with artillery, with muskets, with gunpowder, and with a very small, if required, but extremely well-disciplined group of soldiers. And I'm just reading a book which illustrates this, The Military in British India by T.A. Heathcote, which shows how the British formed these regiments, you know, the great regiments that still celebrate, you know, and I shouldn't say all this in front of Dr. Kulkarni, who is himself a naval man. These regiments were formed by the British, consisting of Indian soldiers who went on to conquer all of India and also were used abroad, not only in the First World War, but they were used in Hong Kong, in Singapore, in other theaters of war. So, you know, the British modernized Indian warfare in a manner that completely changed the history of the Indian subcontinent. And all of this, these changes, these cataclysmic changes, are in this book. So now, to conclude what I'm trying to say, this book is not really a book of revisionism. You know, everybody's clamoring for rewriting history. So this book doesn't, it's not revisionist, but it is a para-history. In other words, it shows you a parallel set of developments over a very large theater with many, many actors. And I beg to disagree with Udayji for a moment here. And I like the idea of the Maratha Confederacy because it really is a prelude, you know, to Indian federalism. If Indian federalism is looking for a model, then it should look, at the Maratha Confederacy, where the power shifted, but they maintained a sense of unity despite internal dissensions. Now, the point is this, that the Mughal period was imperialist and it led to a fragmented polity when the Mughal Empire declined. And in this vacuum, the Maratha Confederacy rose. And, you know, the Marathas ruled Hindustan for 144 years. That's a long period. If you think about the coronation of Shivaji 1674 to the third Anglo-Maratha War, 1818, it's a period of 144 years. And the British ruled India only for 190 years in two batches. East India Company, let's say 1757 to 1857, and then 1858 when India came under the crown to 1947. So it's not as if the British ruled India for a much, much, much more longer era period than the Marathas. So, of course, it's a corrective history of sorts, but it's not revisionist, but it fills in the blanks, as it were. It gives you a wider canvas, and it's not Delhi-centric, which is really important. But the point that I'm really trying to make is that this book, you know, my friend Ganesh Devi says Indian narratives are of two kinds, you know, of one hero, like the Ramayana, the story of, you know, Lord Ramachandra, one predominant protagonist with an antagonist like Ravan, and then a cast of characters, or of many heroes like the Mahabharata. So the extraordinary epoch of Nana Saheb Peshwa is a narrative like the Mahabharata of many heroes. I think Udayji has portrayed this period in a wonderful way with many theaters, you know, north, south, east, west, Bengal in the east, which was India's granary as well as the most, lucrative, richest province of India. And in a way, how the action shifts for economic reasons, that anybody who controlled Bengal would then control India. Of course, Delhi and the Doab, you know, Lucknow, Awadh, Bihar. Of course, Bihar became a part of Bengal after that. Bihar, Bengal and Orissa became, you know, the Bengal presidency later. And far up there in Afghanistan, Peshawar, Attak, you know, that theater. Then, of course, Western India with the Peshwas, Malwa, you know, Holkers and the Sindhyas. And of course, the Bundelas. Then further south, the realm of the Nizam, and right down to Sri Rangapatnam with Tipu and Haider Ali, actually usurping from the Wadiyars, and then further down to Tanjavur and Trichinapalli, right? The Maratha influence, went right down there, except for almost of Kerala. This book encompasses all of India, and a wonderful device of the Vakyanavis, you know, who tells the story. That's why it has these wonderful literary qualities. And it's an unputdownable book. I recommend it very much. And I completely endorse what my Twitter bandhu, my Twitter brother Amit said, that I think that Udayji is going to be like our great historians, Rajwade and Sardesai. He's going to join their ranks. And though, as I said earlier, we may not want to call him an amateur, but what I mean is he's not a trained historian. I think his contribution to this period of the 18th century and to Maratha history is going to rank higher than that of trained historians. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Makrant. Always extremely fascinating to listen to you. The amount of interesting perspectives you have on so many different things. I got 3-4 very interesting points from your talk today, amongst many. But the Swarajya School of History, I think that's a very interesting point worth, and you should also write about it, at least an article, and something to think about. You also talked about the advent of the modern military, how the French and the British took on the often the unorganized armies, not too many times for the Marathas, but definitely of the some of the other local rulers. And Dr. Kulkarni himself, being from a military background, has talked about it very well in this book as well as some of the earlier books. An important point to make here is Marathas were very quick learners. And one of the greats, Mahadji Sindhya, who Dr. Kulkarni is going to write about in one of his upcoming books, was very quick to realize the value of this trained artillery and the European firepower, and was very quick to hire some of the best officers from the French. And it took a very short period of time to change his army completely from a traditional old cavalry to, you know, a very modern European-like disciplined artillery-driven fighting. So Marathas were very good at learning and, you know, taking on the latest technologies. But that's a separate discussion. I'm also going to write a little bit about that. But fascinating points, so many things to cover. But I think we are short on time. So I think now we come to our chief guest. Once again, I'll say that we are very fortunate to have Yashodhara Rajeji to speak with us today. She really doesn't need any introduction, but as the coordinator, I have to mention at least a few lines. So Yashodhara Rajeji is the Minister of Sports and Youth Welfare, Technical Education and Skills Development and Employment of the state of Madhya Pradesh. She was formerly Minister of Commerce, Industries and Employment as well in the state of Madhya Pradesh. She was first elected from Gwalior Lok Sabha to the 14th Lok Sabha in 2007 and has been in active politics for over 3 decades. Over to you, Yashodhara Rajeji. We are really keen to hear from you about your views of the book. And I'm sure you'll have a lot of recommendations for Dr. Kulkarni for his upcoming book.
Thank you
as well
for the introduction, Amit. But you did take away a few years of very hard work, because I've been a 4-time MLA and then a 2-time parliamentarian. And I started my formal politics in 98, even though my informal politics was from 89 at my mother's feet. So a lot of hard work has gone into elections and winning elections and coming back and then working within your constituency. That being said, today I am very honored to be a part of this program, because I'm a great fan of this. I call him the historian of today. Very difficult for people who write books to hold the person, especially during a history book. Today, our lives are very busy, and every one of us, to the younger generation, is on mobiles, digital, running here, there, and everywhere. So nobody has the time really to sit down and read history books unless they're engaging and they catch you. But the problem here was that Dr. Kulkarni's book, the rough book, didn't get to me till 5 days ago. And I love to read my history books, every single word, every single line, and every single chapter. So his talk today, that was half an hour, was just beyond brilliance. To know and to live what he was talking about in front of you was, to me, a great privilege of how I understood how he'd written his book today. I have already read his book, The Solstice of Panipat, which was a tremendous book. You could feel the war clashes, you could see the symbols, you could hear the people cry, and you could feel the people dying. It was such a moving book. And then nobody mentions here that he translated something called the Bakhar of Panipat, which really meant that what happened during Panipat, how many people were there in the army? How many people were there who were carrying the swords? How many carrying spears? How many horses? It was just an amazing set of pages that I saw him translate from what was the language of that day to Hindi and English. Then he, of course, wrote The Era of Bajirao, which was fascinating. So here, from my perspective, and I am neither an intellectual nor a historian, I'm very privileged to be here with Makaranji also, because you people are all achievers, and I feel I've achieved nothing. But it is because of people like Dr. Kulkarni that I understood my legacy, and I understood what the Marathas stood for, and what an amazing group of people they were. They came from villages, and they banded together and came to a point where they had generals who were not taught history, who were not taught how to battle. They learnt on the job, and such brave people conquering all the way length and breadth of India. And in those days, there were no fine lines of Pakistan. So to know that my ancestors went all the way up to Peshawar and Attock and all these other places, right up to maybe even Kabul, was just something fascinating to realize that we simple Marathas here had such a history where if we'd wanted, we could have been, as the Maratha clans, the emperors of India in those days. But we chose not to. The Peshwa chose not to. Chhatrapati chose not to. And the armies, the Marathas supported the emperor, the Mughal emperor, and tried to keep people all the way up to like Abdali at bay. And that was because of that strong sense of commitment to their land. It was not a country, it was land. It was their land. And that was Hindvi Swaraj of Chhatrapati Shivaji. I mean, when I talk about him and I read again and again about this great man and where he came up from and how he was able to put these armies together, what his leadership was all about, what his bravery was all about, and how it translated down to generations on generations. And then you have Uday Kulkarni fleshing it out and showing us, you know, the way of how Bajirao, as a pandit, as a Brahmin, actually took to war and actually led the armies. I mean, that was something that the Peshwa had never done till then, had never really led the armies in battle. And he was doing that at every step, and chopping and changing and running all over the countryside, winning every single battle. And then comes this book, The Epoch of Nana Sahib. And here it then becomes even more multidimensional, because at one point you are just concentrating on the Marathas, but suddenly you see the entry of the British and you see the entry of the French. Till then, you just had mercenaries that were in these armies of the Marathas. So you would read about some Abyssinians, and you would read about Ethiopians, you would read about the Rohillas, who originally came from Afghanistan and went off towards Bareilly side, because Roh in Hindi and Sanskrit means mountain. So they were actually mountain people that came down. And the Rohillas ended up going all the way up to Uttarakhand. So in Uttarakhand, that area was where the Rohillas were. But, you know, at one point, they were all acting as mercenaries within the Maratha Empire, within the Maratha army, within the army of the emperor. Now you come in this Nana Sahib's book to a multidimensional India, and you see the entry of the French in a more formal role. You see the entry of the British in a more formal role. You see the Portuguese. And so he is now becoming like the Peshwa, running north, running south, running east, running west, covering everything. And that he's done so beautifully through that rememberer, the person who keeps coming through so many chapters every time and going back over what you've just read. And that way he's been able to put all this multidimensional together. Hats off to you, Dr. Kulkarni. You put an amazing book together. And I won't take up your time, but today I am a proud Maratha. Unfortunately, we all went off to the north and went further north away from our culture and from the basic sanskar of the land of Maharashtra. But we are all going back to our roots. And sometimes I like to make that analogy of my mother, Vijayaraja Sindhya, who accepted every challenge in her life. And for her, even though she looked so saumya, people would always tell me, oh, your mother was so saumya and so sadgi and so simple. But inside, she was a woman of iron. And there was not a single challenge that she did not meet. And she, I think, was one of those who really pushed the Bharatiya Janata Party, just like all the generals under the Peshwa and under Chhatrapati, pushed to meet the Hindavi Swaraj of Chhatrapati's dreams. That way she pushed because she wanted that Indian nationalism. She was always talking about Bharatiyata. She was always talking about Hindutva. And that Hindutva was not what everybody portrays her to be. And right up to the end, she was there to make sure that finally the Bharatiya Janata Party under Atal Bihari Vajpayee came to power and pushed away all the rest of the parties that were there. And they formed the government, even though it was an NDA government, and virtually put him on that throne. For her, that was like the best thing that could have happened. And believe it or not, that next year she died. So it was like she'd done her job and it was time to go, just like it always happens in history. So to me, when I read books like this, my blood stirs, and I wish I had a horse, a shield and a sword to meet all my challenges that I meet in life, Dr. Kulkarni, because that is how you write your book. You just make it happen in front of you. You know, you'll be like putting out the book and getting onto a horse and your challenges. So I just want to tell people who, new people who may be looking at this streaming going on, that guys, you know, we used to read our history books and some of us used to fall off to sleep. I've read Yavnath Sarkar's history on Shivaji. I've read Sardesai also. But that was another era of writing. That was an era of professorial writing. Now we have the era of the Uday Kulkarni type of writing, who write history like it's supposed to be and yet make it so interesting that it's unputdownable. I'm sure this book, just like the Solstice of Panipat, just like the Bakhar of Panipat, just like the Bajirao book, will be unputdownable. Heartiest congratulations to you, Dr. Kulkarni. It was a singular pleasure taking you and your wife all over our Gwalior area. I learned so much with you, and I look forward to many more adventures like that. Congratulations again.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Yashodhara Rajeji. It's indeed an honor for us in this program, and I'm sure for Dr. Kulkarni as well to have you speak. And the Uday Kulkarni School of History. Another interesting perspective. I'm sure he's going to be very embarrassed with that. And we'll get there eventually. Not right now. Maybe another decade from now after you have done another 3 or 4 books. But let me not embarrass him further. I think we are coming to the end of our program. We are almost on time. So that's great. I'll just highlight one more time that the book is available on Amazon, amazon.in. If you search for Dr. Uday Kulkarni as the author, you will find this as well as the past books. So please do go ahead and start ordering. Uday Kulkarni may promise to sign a few copies. I don't know what his schedule is like, even for some of the online shipments. He's definitely, for those of you here in Pune, definitely do mention that in your note to him, and he's signing off those copies in his clinic. So those are also available to you. So please take advantage of this and make sure you have this book with you. Before I close, Professor Bakran has to make a comment, so I'll let him do that. And then finally, I don't need to speak anything. It's over to Uday for the closing comments. So Makran, first.
Yeah, actually, I'll take advantage of your permission and say two things. One is the magnificent way in which Yashodhara Raje spoke. I say it's just absolutely brilliant. So that was a special treat for me to listen to her. Very, very inspiring. Thank you, ma'am. And the thing I wanted to say is that this is a very Puneri book, you know. That's the reason I put up my hand. You know, the people of Pune, you see, they are mavericks. And when they take up something, they never let go of it. You can have a 8-year-old lady in Navari who will run a marathon. You'll have somebody else who'll start a museum. Someone else will study only the road signs. Someone will start a festival of music. So these Punekars, you can't stop them. Once they take something, and the other thing is that they're not just cranks, okay? They're not just eccentrics. They are actually consummate artists. When they take something up, they do it well. Now, look at this book. See, I must say I've done nothing but read and write all my life. I'm fit for nothing else. And so I really admire, you know, people like Yashodhara Rajeji, who are in the field and, you know, who struggle with politics and so forth. But the point I'm trying to make is it's not easy to publish a book. And Udayji is absolutely right. The publisher will not let you write the way you want to write it, what you want to say. They'll even control the title of a book. So to start your own publishing house, yeah, to put out these books, you know, this is the Pune spirit. And I must say that, look, I've done about 50 books, okay, written and edited. And this book is so beautifully produced. It has so many fine touches. I'll just show you one or two. See, he gives you a little bookmark, okay, so that you don't forget which page. And then for fat books, as used to be the older style, you know, there's also this kind of Reshmi bookmark in the middle. You know, so these small touches, the color plates, everything is so painstakingly and beautifully done. His whole family has helped. His son, who's managing this broadcast just now, his name is also Yash, I'm told. He has helped. So this collective effort is really the team spirit of the Marathas. So I just wanted to say, support this book, buy it, recommend it to others, and you will have value for your money. So thank you all. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you, Amit. Thank you.
I had one more comment, Amit, if I may say so. I just want to give a perspective of something that y'all would never have thought of. As I was reading this book and I was seeing the entry of the British with their artillery and the Portuguese and the with their sailing history, their armada, as they called it, and their top armada, and the French with their artillery, and they'd mentioned the kind of guns they would use, and how in the Battle of Panipat, the Marathas knew that they had to get Ibrahim Khan in because Ibrahim Khan had the cannons to be able to take care of Abdali's artillery. The same way, as finally the Marathas start getting annihilated and the British annihilate the French and start coming up and start making the empire, on the other side of the world, the North American Indian was also getting crushed by the Pilgrims and those who had come in and had formed the New America. And I was reading about their history, and it is so similar in a way, because those Plains Indians ran the whole length and breadth of North America. They had nobody else, it was just them. And then came the Spanish, who tried to conquer, couldn't conquer, but through them they learned about how to ride the horse. And they rode the horse, and they managed to put up a great resistance to the Americans that started coming in. And then there was a formalization and a civil war between the South and the North, and then the guns started coming in. And that was no match to the North American Indian, and how he gets annihilated, how he gets pushed back, how he gets sent to reservations. And it was, in a way, a little bit of an analogy to what happened in India, and how the British rose and how the crown came in and we became a part of the empire. In a way, you know, something like that was happening on the other side of the world. It was interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Uday?
Yeah, I'll just end by a formal but not so formal vote of thanks. As I've mentioned in my book, a lot of people helped me in the making of this book. My son Yash, who's right here, was the first reader of all my drafts, and very critical. And he's now probably telling me to write the next book, because I know the story till 1761. Now you must write after this. Sonia Khare, who has been a copy editor of all my books, she was earlier with Oxford doing their books, and now she's doing it on her own. and she's always done a wonderful job. She's also a sounding board for what I want to write. Dr. S.M. Bhave, who was actually supposed to write the preface to this book, he even read the manuscript. He's a president of the Bharat Itihas Sanshodhak Mandal. Unfortunately, the week that he was going to write it and I had a deadline, he became a little unwell and he could not complete that job. I hope that if he completes it now, I might include it in a second edition, which hopefully will be not too far off. Shri Pandurang Balkavde, who was one of the foremost Maratha historians today and researcher, the young friend of mine who's written a lot of books on Maratha history, Kedar Phalke, they have all been of help during this period. And several libraries, I mean, the Royal Asiatic Society, the British Library, Westminster Abbey, the Metropolitan Museum of New York, Maratha History Museum at Aurangabad, the Salar Jung Museum at Hyderabad, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya at Mumbai, the Bharat Itihas Sanshodhak Mandal at Pune, the Victoria Memorial Calcutta, the Natnagar Samsthan at Sitamau. They have all contributed so many documents and pictures which I could use for this book. In Bengal, when I traveled to 2 years back, Dr. Tathagata Niyogi, I must mention that he spared 3 days of his time, took me around all the places around Calcutta and Sirampur and Chandranagar and so on, showed me those places. My friend Brigadier Lahiri, with whom he's online right now, with whom I traveled across Bengal to Plassey, Dainhat, where Raghuji Bhosle and Bhaskaram had their base, and where the ruins of those pictures are still there in this book, and Murshidabad, Qasim Bazar, and Vishnupur, where, of course, the famous cannon was supposed to have been used by the deity there to fight with the Marathas. Dr. Swapan Chakrabarti was formerly the director of the Victoria Memorial. My friend Brigadier Rathan Brijbasi, who helped me in Calcutta. Tanjavur, Tiruchirappalli, Srirangam, all these places I had to visit. The visit to Fort Vijayadurg was with the noted historian Ninad Bedekar, whom we all miss today. Kulaba Fort at Ali Bagh, the forts at Revdanda and Chaul, Fort of Janjira, again Panipat and so on. I had been in my earlier books again. Then I had gone to Golconda, Udgir, Dharur, which gave me an idea of those places. Vishakhapatnam was, of course, when I was in the Navy, I spent a lot of time there. Cuttack I had been at that time. I had even traveled upstream in an Indian naval ship up the river Hooghly when the New Moor Island controversy was going on with Bangladesh in 1982. And we went to Haldia that time. This castle of Surat, which is there, the East India Company factory at Surat, which is now just a wall left. All these places I went. In England, I went to the Robert Clive Trail when Dr. Vasudev Gokhale, who was a nonagenarian in Manchester, personally drove me to the church where Clive was baptized and buried, and in an unmarked grave, I might add. Then I went to the Powis Castle at that time, saw the Clive collection, which is mostly made of Indian items. And I would say that I'm overwhelmed by the tributes, by the kind of words that have been used by Yashodhara Rajeji and Makarand, Dr. Professor Makarand Paranspe, about my style of writing. But I always feel that today we can write the history because we are standing on the shoulders of all those historians who wrote down the primary sources, who brought out these primary sources for the last 150 years, right from, say, Kashinath Shastri or from Vasudev Shastri Khare or Yadunath Sarkar or Rajwade. It is on their building blocks that we are able to write the history today. And I think that we owe a great debt of gratitude to these people. So I think that finally, I won't forget that the book's quality is primarily because of my printing press again in Narayanpet at Pune called Mudra. It is run by Sujit Patwardhan, and his team of Yogesh and Rohini and Amod, they have been very, they've been very driven, kind of say, to make this book of good quality. And of course, finally, I'd like to say thank you to my own publishing firm, Bula Mutha Publishers, for having so faithfully allowed me to do what I wanted to do with my work. And I hope that in the years to come, I'll be able to write some more books and continue this narrative of 18th century. Thank you very much once again to all of you, the chief guests who come here. Thanks a lot for coming here. I'll just end the picture by a short video, which was a 30-second video of the book. And I'm sure all of you will get an idea of what by looking at this video. viewers for bearing with us for such a long time on a Sunday morning. So let's hope that they read the book too. Thank you very much.
I think that this concludes our program. Once again, the book is available on Amazon. Thank you for sharing 2 hours this morning with us, and have a good day.
Thank you.
End the broadcast. What are you doing?